right, welcome to our online part. We've been talking bad about y'all, so now we let you in on the word. I'm just kidding. Welcome to Wednesday Night Bible Study. We're glad that each of y'all are here, whether you're here or online or wherever you are. We are thankful that you're able to join us and be with us. And for those in the parking lot, they are massively confused right now, but that is all right. But it's good to have each and every one of y'all. We're going to start off by entering into his gates with thanksgiving and praise, and we're going to have Miss Rhonda come in and lead us in some worship. I need to move this stuff on for our
thing. Okay, you'll just get a hymn book and turn to 93, a very old, familiar song, the old rugged cross.
Amen.
We're going to do the first, second, and last verses.
Gotten caught caught by the police, and you got to think, couldn't help think the man, if they'd been in church, they would have got pulled over. But I'll just leave that there. No, we pray for the safety of the officer and both of them there, and hopefully God will keep them both safe. So we're jumping into the second book of Psalm. Now I'm going to be jumping out of Psalm 54, but the second book has 31 psalms in it. Their main idea behind it is deliverance. And so, as I said, we went from last week talking about the humanity and the love of God toward humanity, and now we see God's deliverance of humanity. The doxology is offered in chapter 72, 18 through 19. And so, as before we get started in this, I just want to kind of give us a little overview of everything. And just remind you that the main theme is we worship God for who He is and what He has done. So before we get started, let's open up in prayer, and we will jump in here and hopefully do a flyover of book number two. Dear Father, we thank You so much for this day. We thank You for loving us. We thank You for Your kindness. And Father, I thank You so much for the old rugged cross, Lord. For without it, we would be a sinner with no ability to come to a Savior, Lord. We wouldn't even have enough sacrifices to make up for how sinful of a nation we are and how sinful of a people we are. But Father, You saw into the future, Lord, and You saw that there would be some, Lord, that would believe on Your Son and accept the sacrifice, Lord. And so, Father, I thank You so much for that, Lord. I thank You for the opportunity to stand and present the gospel and to still preach the gospel. And so, Father, we just ask You to just be with us tonight, Lord. Help us to learn and glean from David's psalm here that he is writing out of desperation. And so, Father, we just ask You to be with us here tonight. Some of the unique features here, as I have found, is the unique features, the five that contain psalms that were ascribed to the sons of Korah. Now, the sons of Korah were a group of Levite temple singers. They were the preachers that could sing, if you want to know that. I was not a part of that group. I was part of the other group, the Norah group. No singing, but these were the ones who could sing, and they sing in the temple. Secondly, it uses the two rather obscure Hebrew terms in the superscription of almost half of them, Maskil, which is contemplative poem, and Makatim, a prayer. And third, it is referring to God. In the second book, it refers to Him as God over the Eternal One, which you are most associated with the word Yahweh, or Yahweh. I think probably pronounced it as Yahweh. But many names of God just show some of the character and descriptions of the one true God. It's not, David is not praying to a different God, it's just using different descriptions. If you want a good description or a good idea of that, many people sometimes they pray, they say, Oh Lord, or Dear Heavenly Father, or Jesus, or Father, or Oh Lord, or however they pray. That's just another name that they use to reference God, still speaking to the same God. So if you have your Bibles, we'll be in Psalm 54. I'm not in Psalm 54. I don't know why I'm from 2 Corinthians there. But Psalm 54. Maybe I should have preached out of that. But also I wanted to mention, since we were online, and I just love embarrassing folks, if you all get a chance to hit Miss Debbie Cox's Facebook, tell her happy birthday tonight, and let her know that she is loved and prayed for. She's here with us, and I just love embarrassing her. So happy birthday, and we pray that you have a wonderful day. And if you turn back to 1 Samuel 16, we see that David is anointed king. And so I just want to give you a little bit of foundation. David is anointed king while Saul was still in there. So this infuriates Saul. And so Saul wants to go after him, and he wants to kill him. And let me flip over here and give you a little passage. And so in 1 Samuel 23:19, it says, "Then the Ziphites came upon Saul at Gilboa, saying, 'Is David not hiding with us in the strongholds in the woods, in the hills of Halakoth, which is on the south of Jezreel? Now therefore, O king, come down according to all the desires to your soul, to come down to our part, and shall be delivered him unto the king's hand.'" And so Saul is plaguing this, and then he's saying, for he's told very correct. He's even telling him, "Hey, be sure you know where he is, because I'm told he's very crafty. See therefore and take knowledge of all the lurking places where he hides, and come back to me with certainty, and I will go with you." And so we start this off with David finding out the Ziphites, however you want to call them, the Ziphites, went to Saul and said, "Hey, we know where David's hiding." Now, David's been on the run, man. I mean, he's been trying to stay out of Saul's way. He's been lucky. He's been fortunate. And now these guys go and tell on him and say, "Hey, we know where he's at. Come kill him. You know, come get him. We're going to deliver him to your hand." So I start this off tonight. I wonder if anybody here or anybody under the sound of my voice has ever felt like they've been backed into a corner. Have you ever felt like you've been backed into a corner or even betrayed by someone? Maybe it's a friend, maybe it's somebody you don't know, or maybe you've been let down or disappointed. I mean, if you can imagine being David, I mean, he's minding his own business. At no time do you see that David has offended these people. They just wanted to, I guess, make Saul their close buddy. They wanted to go tell on him and get him in trouble per se. So I can almost understand that David would have felt like he was backed into a corner and betrayed. And I'm sure many of us have been in times where we felt betrayed or backed into a corner. But I want you to listen to David's prayer. Listen to David as he prays for deliverance. He starts off in verse 1. "Save me, O God, by your name, and vindicate me by your strength. Hear my prayer, O God. Give ear to my words of my mouth. For strangers have risen up against me, and oppressors have sought after my life. They have not set God before them. Behold, God is my helper. The Lord is with those who uphold my life. He will repay my enemies for their evil and cut them off in your truth. I will freely sacrifice to you. I will praise your name, O Lord, for it is good, for he has delivered me out of all trouble, and my eye has seen its desire upon my enemies." I want you to understand something. As you look at David's prayer, the first thing I want you to see is that he is praying for deliverance, not through any other way, but by the name of God and by the power of God. He's not saying, "God, I want you to do this." He's not telling God how to do it. He's saying, "God, the only way I can do it is through you and by your strength." It might do some of us some good to realize that whenever we run into some troubles, instead of giving God the options that he needs to give us, maybe we just need to rely that God's going to bring us through our troubles through his name and through his strength. So we see David relying completely on the name of God for his deliverance and the strength of God for his vindication. And so he's given this, he's seeking that God be honored. He's saying, "Save me, O God, by your name, and vindicate me by your strength." He's saying, "Hey God, I want you to save me, but I want you to get the honor and glory for it. I want them to see you when they save me." And you know, he's not saying, "Hey, help me build up an army so I can come in here and they can say, look how strong David is." He's saying, "God, I want you to save me, and I want them to praise your name when it's done." Hey, it's good whenever you know. I've said this. We said this a couple of weeks ago on men's night. Whenever we get to the end of our rope is when God can truly start working. And I believe if you can really imagine David being in the wilderness, I feel like David's maybe at the end of his rope. And so now he's at the point where he's saying, "God, I want them to know your name and I want them to know your power." So he's seeking God's attention. How many times would it do us some good to to maybe seek God's attention a little bit more than we seek the world's attention. I notice a lot of times when we have troubles come up, we like to rely on people and this, that, and the other. We'll talk to friends. But I wonder how many of us have talked to God before we go to talk to somebody else. I was listening to a radio station that I don't care to repeat today. It's a Christian radio station, but they said, you know what? We are having trouble differentiating what we like better, our words to God or God's words to us. And I was sitting there thinking, okay, I want God's word to me. I forget my prayers. I mean, I may say a prayer tonight, and he may call me tomorrow and say, now, how did you say that prayer? I have no idea. How did you say that scripture? I know. Hold on a minute. Save me, O God, by your name. I remember his words, because his words are important. My words are not. And so he's seeking God's honor. He's seeking God's attention on him. He's saying, hear my prayer, O God. And the circumstances is because he's got some strangers and violent men. I listened to a Fruitland professor today. He was preaching in the thing, and he was talking about being exiles in a country. And he said, now more than ever have pastors become more and more exile in the country. If you look around and you hear at some of the churches, some are completely shut down and closed off. And I mean, there's cobwebs on the pulpit, and the world is praising these pastors. And these pastors that are getting out and preaching and doing these things, the world is crucifying them. They're saying, look at them. They're this, they're that. But we have a message that we have to get out. So we get to the point where we become exiles in our own country. And so David had some folks that were out to get him. They had risen up. They were strangers. As I said before, nowhere do I see, and maybe you might correct me later, nowhere do I see that David would have offended them to cause them to do this. These people are just doing this, I guess, to get Saul on their side. And so they have not set God before them. He says, my oppressors have sought after my life, and they have not set God before them. What that is saying is they're not godly men. They're not doing God's work. They're going against what God has for his life. If you remember, Saul was anointed and then David was. So that was God's, both men were anointed. And you know, even just to show you just what the anointing meant then, let me go over right here. In Psalm 24, Samuel 24, right after this, Saul goes up and goes after him. And that happened when Saul returned following the Philistines and was told David is in the wilderness of Enkedah. So then Saul took 3,000 men, and y'all know this story. He went up, he saw a cave, and he said, I'm going to use this cave for just a minute, for lack of better words. And David was in that cave, and David cut the edge of his cloth off. And why did David become so burdened? Because David had touched the anointed. God had anointed Saul, if you remember. And so he felt bad because he had sinned against what God's law was, that you touch not the anointed. So that's why even Saul was going against God to kill God's anointed, and David cut his cloth and felt bad. That's the difference between someone who is following after God and someone who is not. Listen, there can be people that are in the same church house and one following after God and one not following after God. And that's the picture we want to create here. It's the heart of the person and how they feel whenever they sin. And verses 4, we see, the first thing we saw was we looked to God in prayer. The next thing is we looked to God in faith. Faith in God as our deliverer. It is, I added this on here this just a few minutes ago, and I would be amiss not to add it. It is by and through God's name and by and through his strength that we are able to do anything. And so verses 4 and 5, he says, behold, God is my helper. The Lord is with those who uphold my life, and he will repay my enemies for their evil and cut them off in your truth. Faith in God as our helper. You know, we have a lot of things that we can maybe rely on this day, but David is trying to get you to see here that God is his helper. He's our sustainer, our vindicator, and he is the only one that we need to put our faith in to bring bring us through to the other side of whatever troubles we may be facing. Now, I know some may be reading this and thinking, man, preacher, you're kind of overstepping here. David's in fear for his life, and I'm just having trouble maybe paying a tower bill. Listen, the same God that brought David through that time is the same God that will bring you through your financial trouble. Now, I'm not going to sit up here and say that God's got a big house and five cars and six wives and three horses for you, but I am going to say that God will supply all your needs, no horses, supply all your needs.
Not six wives.
And not six wives either. But he will supply your needs, and he will be faithful to take care of you. Now, you may not have all you want, but you will have all that you need. And so as long as you are faithful to God, he is faithful to you. As we've seen, as we've made our way through the Old Testament, when does things start getting bad for the Israelites? When they turn their backs on God. They begin to walk the other way. And so we see that God is forever faithful. It's his people that continually turn away. And here, this last point, we look to God in thanksgiving. We look to him in prayer and faith and thanksgiving. I will freely sacrifice to you. I will praise your name. If your Bible has that capitalized, that is because it is referring to a deity. It is referring to God. It's not. He's not talking about any other thing other than God. Oh Lord, for it is good. For he has delivered me out of all my trouble, and my eye has seen its desire upon my enemies. Listen, as I started out tonight saying, sometimes we can get a little hasty and forget to thank God for the little things. Listen, when God brings you through something, don't be so hasty to run into the next thing. Maybe stop and say, thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Thank you, Lord, for protecting me. Thank you, Lord, for keeping me. So we go to God in prayer by faith with thanksgiving. And we skip that thanksgiving a lot. But here we got David saying, I will freely sacrifice to you. He's given it all. This is a man who has been anointed, who has it all, and will soon have it all, and have it all at his disposal. And he's saying, even I will freely sacrifice unto you. That is not a man who considers himself above God. That is a man that's at the top of the totem pole that is fully submitted to who God is. And so he submits himself, and I will praise your name, O Lord, for it is good. For he has delivered me out of all trouble. Now we know how David's life goes. We know that David doesn't live his best life always. He fails, he falters, he messes up. But I challenge you to show me one time where God fails. Not one single time. You see where God failed David. David failed his kingdom. David failed his home. But God never failed him. And I'm glad I serve a God that doesn't keep a tally mark on me. Because if he did, I'd be in big trouble. But we go to God in prayer by faith and thanksgiving. Look at David's problems and think. Don't be so easily beset about what he's going through that you miss the fact that that same God is the God that is present in you. It would do some of us some good to get over that, what they call it, whenever the Baptist preacher starts preaching on the Holy Spirit, everybody gets all uncomfortable. It would do us some good to get over that worry about what the Holy Spirit might cause you to do and submit to the Holy Spirit and say, man, I'm going to follow after him no matter what. Because in the end, it's not going to matter what my word says, no matter what his word says. Fully submit as David. I mean, I think of David's life. I'm like, man, he just fully gave it over. He just free. I will freely sacrifice to you. I will praise your name. And if you missed everything tonight, I want you to get this. I'm gonna go right back up to verse 1. Save me, O God, by your name, and vindicate me by your strength. problems and troubles to the Lord. I know you've heard me say this before, and I don't mean to sound all cliche, but when we take our problems to the Lord, I want you to remember this old saying. Stop telling God how big your problems are, and start telling your problems how big your God is. We spend a lot of time telling God how big the problems we have. We ought to spend our time telling our problems how big God we have. Amen?
Amen.
Something to think about. When we get into predicaments, do we have confidence that God hears our prayers? I pray if you're having trouble with that, that you read Psalm 54 and put God, say, God, by your name and by your strength, deliver me. Whether you're in a cave running from the law, or whether you're facing a bill, or a financial struggle, or stage four, whatever it is, cry out to God. He'll hear you. And pray that He be glorified in your life. And He'll do things that will just blow your mind. No. Abide in the Lord. Live the word. Pray the word. Read the word. Amen. No. Father God, we thank you so much for this day. God, I pray as we continue to make our way through Psalms, as we see each part, each idea. Last week, Lord, we learned about the humanity and the love that you have for humanity. This week, we see that you deliver. You're a delivering God. Father, I'm so thankful that you're a God that can hear us. You're a God that can answer us. You're a God that leads and guides and directs, Lord. It's us that cut off that communication. So, Father, I pray that you, wherever each person that's gathered here tonight, wherever their heart is, Lord, maybe whatever struggle they may be going through, Lord, but that they just realize that they can cry out and say, save me, O God, by your name and by your strength. Let your name be glorified and let your strength be seen, not of my own, but make it all.